Alright guys, welcome back to the Hour of Kwonmunism, number 5. So, continuing on with the comments I received on my videos this week, the next comment was in the video, I now owe Citibank and Discover $93,000. That's the video. The person who commented was RathMont313. And this is the comment. What do you recommend to a college freshman who currently has $7,000 in debt? So I responded to him with a YouTube comment, but I thought this was an interesting comment to just kind of talk about. First of all, it's interesting that this question is addressed to me, who has about, you know, a lot of debt. $7,000 in debt to me means really nothing. That's a lucky number to me, lucky low number to me, because I have such a huge debt in comparison. And for a year or so, I wasn't succeeding at paying back my loan, so it's interesting to get a question like this, asking for my advice or for what I recommend to a college freshman who is currently $7,000 in debt. I mean, the thing is, I went into, you know, getting private loans for college education because I knew that I was in a privileged situation. My mom was at the time making a huge amount, great amount of income. She was making a six-digit income, a six-figure salary, making over $100,000 a year. So I knew, and that's not including my dad's salary as a pastor. So I already knew at the time that my family was a privileged one. And so I realized that, you know, I thought at the time that my plan was to get my degree, get some loans, and to, you know, start getting a job right after college and start paying it back. That was the plan. Didn't really work out that way. I mean, it still kind of worked out, but it didn't work out that way. But I guess my advice would be to, you know, before you get any loans, make sure you know what you're getting into. Make sure you know your situation, your limits. You're going to have co-signers, and they're usually going to be your parents. So have great relationship with your parents because you're going to need them after you graduate. And you know, you want to always make sure, by great relationship, I mean, do something nice for them every once in a while. You know, remember their anniversary, remember their birthdays, remember Mother's Day, remember Father's Day, have great relationship with your co-signers. Great relationship is really important with paying back your loan in the future. Keep great relationship with your professors in college, because you're going to need a recommendations letter when you go to graduate school, or when you start applying for jobs or for internships and things that matter, and start planning ahead, thinking for the future of what kind of job you're going to get into. And you know, that really is my advice, and it's really an advice I should follow myself wholeheartedly, that I had a trouble following because of situation and stuff, and also because of my laziness. But yeah, that's really what I would say. $7,000 in debt right now, which means that was your first year. I don't know how you got to that number. Does that mean you're going to pay $7,000 every year and end up with about $40,000 in debt once you graduate, from your undergraduate college? I don't know. $40,000 is still a lot of money. Oh, also another big advice. If you get any loans, try to get government loans or government-type loans and not private loans. That's going to make a really big difference. See, all my loans are private loans, and that makes my life a living hell. Because private banks don't give you much flexibility or don't give you much options. That's probably not going to be another video topic for me to do, but that's really important. If you get any loans, try to get government loans. You're going to get cussed out a lot by people on YouTube if you do, and then you make a video about it saying, I have all these in government loans, because people are going to be like, you're the problem that this country is in shambles or whatever. Whereas if they say that to me, I can be like, look, no taxpayer money went to mine, except for banks doing suspicious shit. All mine are private loans. So directly speaking, I didn't take any money from taxpayers. It's the banks that did that, not me. But I really recommend you get government loans, you get more options. And there's going to be future legislation, like Elizabeth Warren is fighting for legislation that will really help students in your situation and in my situation. So definitely, that's really all I have to say. Already a lot. I talked a lot with just that one comment. The next comment comes from the video, The Beauty of a Universe Without Any Gods. This is one of those videos I did last week talking about the how life can be such a considered such a precious thing if, in fact, there is no such thing as any god or higher power in the universe. Which, of course, I expected a lot of opposition to this kind of video, considering that, you know, yeah, I expected a lot of opposition, and I do get some opposition. The opposition comment comes from, this comment comes from 74 Bob Lilly, and the you can check out that person's channel with this link. So the person says, the problem is that looking at this universe, it appears way too suspiciously tailored for us to live in. Even Stephen Hawking admits that it appears suspiciously tailored. See chapter 7 of his book, The Grand Design. You say you're going to do a fine-tuning video. That's great. I will look forward to it. So that was the person's first comment, and I kind of responded briefly. I said, you know, I mean, I will make a fine-tuning video, although I don't really see it as a great argument for a really intelligent designer, considering how 99.99999999999% of the universe is totally not inhospitable for any living being. I don't know why God would design a universe to be like that. That was just one of the things I said. And this is what 74 Bob Lilly comments in response. Most of an automobile isn't appropriate for passengers to ride in or on, e.g. crankshaft, axle, back bumper, etc. Yet it is pretty much tailored for humans to ride in. Hawking focuses more on the subatomic items that have to be set perfectly for us to exist, and the development of the universe being tailored to facilitate our existence. So, before I respond, thanks for watching my videos, even though I know my viewpoints are totally... You don't agree with my viewpoints, and you still watched it, and you still commented, so thanks for that. Now, I find your analogy super problematic, I find your comment super problematic, and I'll definitely be responding to some of the points raised by something like the fine-tuning argument in a future video. But the analogy is problematic in that you're thinking that, this is what you say, most of an automobile isn't appropriate for passengers to ride in or on. That's not true. Most of an automobile is appropriate. Not only that, it's not only appropriate for riding it or for... that's not the only thing. It's beneficial to the passengers. Crankshaft, back bumper, that is all beneficial to the passenger. The analogy, you need to make an analogy where 0.0000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000 is. Only planet Earth, and only certain parts of planet Earth, is hospitable for life. Every part, you know, all the other parts of the universe, all the other parts of planet Earth, is completely horrible for a person to live in. It's horrible. 99.999999999999% of the universe is not beneficial for human beings, or for any life, actually. So that you need to come up with an analogy that fits that. And that fits that, and is actually designed, intelligently designed by a designer. Why would a designer make a product that is 99.999999% not beneficial to the intended user? Why would God do that? Why would any intelligent designer do that? That is not intelligent design. That is just crappy design. But that's something I will address in a future video about the fine-tuning argument. It's definitely my most favorite argument that creationists use, but it's still an argument that I find very, very, very problematic. So that's that. Okay, so, wow, I got a lot of comments this week. I've still got so much more to go. So, the next comment comes from the video, An Atheist Reads the Holy Bible, King James Version, Genesis 1. And the person that says this is Curtis Zissler. And Curtis Zissler says this: "It's fun to make up stuff on what the Bible means, what this word means in the Bible, what we want it to mean. That's why there are so many versions of Bible, and each version means something different to each person." I don't know what the intention was in this comment, but sure, I totally agree with that. it is fun to make stuff up what the Bible means. But in the Bible reading project that I'm doing, I'm trying to read the Bible as literally as possible and trying to get the interpretations that are, that can be, you know, that makes the most sense, but trying to also bring up the point that a lot of what the Bible says literally is hard to reconcile with scientific evidence because they don't match. That doesn't make sense scientifically. And also, this is the point I want to make. It doesn't match with our moral compass, our modern moral compass. And it makes us cringe because we have our own morality that is so different from what the Bible says it is, because we have evolved into society. That's really what I want the whole point, this whole Bible reading project to be. How do we reconcile faith in the Bible with scientific evidence? How do we reconcile faith in the Bible with our modern moral compass? And that's really the question I want to keep bringing up as I'm reading the Bible on YouTube. The next comment comes from Plus I'm Your Friend. I love the name. Plus I'm Your Friend comments, in the unedited Hebrew version, Shamayim means sky, but there is another word, Rakia, which means firmament. Genesis 1, chapter 1, verse 7 says, how God separated the water from up there, heaven's Rakia. That's how they explain why the stars are floating up there. And a few chapters later, used the myth to explain where the flood water came from. Definitely interesting. Thank you for the clarification on Hebrew. Like I said, I don't know Hebrew, so thanks for that. That knowledge is always useful. I did look a little bit up about Shemayim. I mean, I Googled the word, so it's not much of a research. But Shemayim seems to suggest that it does seem to connote God's dwelling place. So it is correct that the King James Version and the New International Version and all the English versions of the Bible uses the word heaven. It is definitely much more correct that this word heaven is used instead of sky when considering the connotations of the word Shemayim. So that's interesting. So when God created the heaven and the earth, it actually means that God created not just the sky, but a place where God dwells. Really interesting, and of course, it's one way, when we interpret it one way about the whole water vapor canopy theory, there is water floating above the sky before the flood happens, so that does kind of, it's an interesting thing to think about, and of course, I made a couple of videos about this topic altogether, so let me not talk too much about it. Let's move on. Actually, I might have to move on in another video. So, in the continuing video, I will continue this hour of Kwonmunism in the next video. I hope you guys enjoyed my commenting on comments so far.